Good morning. Amber, thank you for playing hurt this morning. Back was a little tight, but we thank you. I appreciate it. So, we're in the midst of 3 weeks of stewardship. This is week number two. Number two. We're halfway there. So, when I say stewardship, you used to think,
show me the money!
But you don't think that anymore, right? Now you think wellness, the wellness wheel, our collective wholeness. Last week I got home from worship and my wife said, "You know I teach the wellness wheel, right?" And I was like, "Yeah, I kind of pay attention sometimes." So you might have noticed the thing. This is brownie points for me. There's a plug in the bulletin, your weekly handout. We're going to do a seminar, not we. She's going to do a seminar on keeping your wellness wheel rounded, because like she teaches that, as she told me. So last week we went from show me the money to wholeness. This week I want to go a step further, and not just wholeness, but that thing. Do you know what that is? It's okay, I don't either. It's kind of like a pretzel. I like that. That makes me hungry. That fits with Jessica and the food theme she has going on with our youth. So it's really just a symbol for interconnectedness, because all of that stuff is connected. It's about being interconnected, because in fact, we are all interconnected. In God's vision of creation, we're all connected. The well-being of any impacts the well-being of all. We're interconnected. Inside the church, outside the church, there's no fine print. There's no fine print. We are all interconnected as part of God's family. Because in God's view of creation, we're all created in God's image. It's God's sense of stewardship, that deep sense of connectedness, from which we must approach all of our conversations regarding stewardship. Now, Bishop Eaton frequently reminds us, we are church together, and we are church for the sake of the world. We are church together, and we are church for the sake of the world. Now, I'm not sure that Paul would use those exact words. I don't think Paul used those exact words in his letter to the Corinthians as he tried to get them to participate in the Macedonian offering, which is what our reading is about today. In his writing, he's trying to compel the church to give. Not for their benefit, but for the benefit of each, for the benefit of all. So when we talk stewardship, it's important that we realize our interconnectedness. And the wellness wheel isn't just about our individual collectiveness. It's about the community's wholeness, the community's connectedness, all of us. Because we each have different gifts. We each have different skills to use and to lift up for the body of Christ. The well-being of any impacts the well-being of all. So let's take a look at ourselves first. Look around. Not just the person next to you, but look around. Some of you aren't looking. Look around. So the beauty is, we're all connected, but how we engage in ministry, how we participate in ministry is important. This is what I like to call the dysfunction bus principle. How many of you want to jump on the dysfunction bus? No takers. How we do ministry together matters. How we do ministry together matters. Now, I'm going to give you an example. You don't want me taking this microphone, turning it on, and singing and leading our worship service musically. I trust you. You do not. So we give the microphone to people like Brittany, And we say, Brittany, can you please sing? Because God knows I can't. And then Brittany does the music part. But here's the best part. When Brittany leads and we all sing, oh my God, it sounds beautiful. We joined all our voices and connect them together. And there's that saying about a joyful noise. It's true. It's beautiful. And you got your microphone back. I saw you guys try to get that microphone. What we do in ministry together matters. We just had a pile of kids up here. And there's perhaps no better example of our connectedness and the importance of our connectedness than our youth. Question. How do they learn? How do they grow in their faith? Quiet bunch today. From us. Yeah. So the first answer to that question is their parents, right? Now it's easy to say, well, mom and dad, you're off the hook. Well, we're not. We're not. The first place that faith is built is with families, is with parents. It's the saying, faith is caught, not taught. So if you're driving through the little turnaround here, push your kids out the door and then go to Starbucks for an hour, they're probably not going to catch much in terms of faith. Well, I'm going to drop them off at the church for an hour and you guys will download faith into them and then they're all good. It doesn't work that way. Faith is caught, not taught. But here's the thing. When we use this font, you know what happens here, right? We do a baptism, and then I turn to you all, and I ask you all a question. And you all get really excited, and you say, we do, we ask God to help and guide us. Well, the question I ask is, are you participating? Are you connecting? Are you interconnecting with our youth to participate in their faith formation? So, the first step has to be the parents. But we can't bail on that responsibility either. It's all of our responsibility. It's our interconnectedness that makes it great. Why do youth leave the church? The number one reason youth leave the church is because they are not connected to anyone who's not paid. Oh yeah, I know Pastor Chad. Oh, I know Miss Jessica, or I know Miss Jen, or I know Pastor Rebecca. But do they have those other connections within this faith community? Do you know what's going on in the youth of our church? It's important. It's important to be active participants, not just in our own kids' lives, but in all of our kids' lives. We're connected. Otherwise, it's an uphill battle. But when parents and congregations join together, connect together, beautiful things happen. We can break that stereotype. And that's how you break that stereotype. If our stewardship is about wholeness, if our stewardship is about connectedness, we can be more than that stereotype. And remember, faith is a muscle. Faith is a muscle. Nobody's faith deepens by not coming to worship. Now, I know that there's other ways to worship, but I know that you can do daily devotions, and I know that you can experience God outside these walls, but there's a beauty to the connectedness, and when one is missing, someone's missing out. It's about that connection, that connectedness. Now, we're all connected at Immanuel. We're all connected inside these walls this morning. We're also connected to the Florida Bahamas Synod. We're connected to 176 other ELCA congregations in the state of Florida. It's part of our connectedness. That connectedness provides support for struggling congregations, for new congregations, for seminaries, for colleges and universities. We're all connected. Each synod is then connected to the churchwide office, 65 other synods. And 9,300 other congregations. Now, to do the work that we do individually, we couldn't do it. We couldn't support seminaries. We couldn't support global mission. We couldn't support all those other things. But collectively, in our interconnectedness, we're able to do so much more. That's what Paul's talking about with this offering, the Macedonian offering. The sense of connectedness. Now, Reverend Dr. Steve Bowman, who's executive director, or was, I believe he recently retired, was executive director for Congregational and Synodical Mission at the ELC office in Chicago. He said, and I quote, "In God's vision, we are all deeply connected. The vision of abundance for all is the steward's primary lens. Money and mission support is a referendum on relationships. Priorities are clarified. It's a spiritual issue." Now, he wrote that as part of a book called How Much Is Enough? The focus of that book clearly was on the financial part of stewardship. And while I agree with his statement, I want to take it a step further. And I want to add to that statement, time, money, and mission support is a referendum on relationships. We were created to be in relationship. Way back in Genesis, we were created to be in relationship. How we give, what we give, and whom we give, not just money, but time, is important. It's important. So where do we invest our time? Where do we invest our money? Where do we invest our resources? Now, Jesus tells us where our treasure is, our heart will be also. What are we investing in? Are we investing in our faith? Are we spending time nurturing and cultivating our faith? Now, I'm not naive. I've got kids and work and everything else, just like many of us. We're busy. You look at our calendars, and for you retired folks, I don't know how you do it. You manage to take your schedule, and then you retire, and then it gets more full. See, look at you all. You're like, yep. My dad was just here to visit, and like, oh, we have this on this thing, and we'll try and squeeze you in. Like, you're retired. But they literally are squeezing us in. I don't know how you all do it. So when I say, are we spending time on our faith? You go, how do I fit that into my schedule? Now, many of you are familiar with the biblical practice of tithing. I said tithing, so take a deep breath, everybody. That's like the four-letter word of stewardship. But bear with me. Let's talk about tithing our time, because that's an easier conversation than telling y'all you need to give 10% of your income. Let's talk time. Okay, so there's 24 hours in a day. Somebody help me with the math. 10% of 24 hours is how much? 2.4 hours, right? I think. Move the decimal point. 2.4 hours. Where are the math teachers at? 2.4. 2.4 hours. If we're tithing our day, we're spending 2.4 hours nurturing our faith. And now you're going, that guy's funny. So I'm not going to tell you to tithe your faith. You know how much time you spend on your faith. So let's say, pick a number. Because if I say you need to spend 2.4 hours on your faith each day, because there's 24 hours in one day, if I say you need to spend 2.4 hours on your faith and you're spending 5 minutes, you're going to look at me and tell me 2.4 is crazy. And you know what? You're probably right. To go from 5 minutes to 2 hours is kind of nuts. And you're still going, I can't fit that into my schedule unless I just don't sleep. Or I go into work late, which I don't advise, because then that messes up your wellness wheel. So pick that number. So if you're spending 10 minutes on your faith, increase it. Spend 15 or spend 20. But be intentional. Because for me, stewardship isn't about tithing. It's about being intentional. And it's about trying to grow. Grow your faith, grow your stewardship, grow your giving. So I'm not saying give 10%. If you do, great, thank you. But it's about being realistic and evaluating where you are in your faith journey and saying, okay, so I'm spending 10 minutes on my faith. So I challenge you to increase it. You know what? I'm going to spend 15. I'm going to spend 15. Because that's doable. To say you're going to go from 5 minutes to 2 hours is crazy. Nancy's verifying that. And I know that. But if we can strengthen our relationship, if we can strengthen our connectedness to each other and to God, we're starting to live out God's creation. We're starting to live out God's fullness and God's abundance. So when I say stewardship,
show me the money!
I'm not just talking about money. When I say stewardship, I'm talking about wholeness, making sure that our wheel stays rounded both individually and collectively. And when I talk stewardship, I'm talking about the fact that we are all interchangeably connected. We all have different gifts and skills and abilities. We're all at different seasons in our lives. But we're all connected. It's all part of God's stewardship. We're all part of God's creation. And in God's view, in God's care of creation, our connections to one another and our connections to Christ and how we use them matter. So be intentional. Be intentional. Let us pray.